sing us some Jamaican song. But if we sing them, you got to get out of those seats and you got to dance like you're really from Jamaica.
Remember when the speaker came up with me?
Heavenly Father, with voices crying out with praise upon their lips, we commence our time of worship and praise and hearing from your precious word today. And once again, Almighty God, we ask for the presence of the Holy Spirit to continue to govern this time of worship. We pray, God, that as we continue to open our mouths and we open our hearts and minds, that we will allow the Spirit of God to soothe our minds, to soothe our beings, but God, to help us to be receptive to what you will say to us today in this house of worship. Let your name and your name alone be glorified in this house of worship. We ask and say these things in Jesus' holy and precious name. And God's people said, amen. Amen and amen. The word of God encourages us to praise him. And we all know this portion of scripture, and let it ring true to each and every one of us as we praise him and worship him today. A psalm of praise, Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. So church, stand and let us make a joyful noise unto the Lord. We're going to worship him. We're going to sing, and his name will be magnified. Come on now. Come on now. Stand. Stand. And put your hands together. Let's say praise the Lord. Come on, put your hands together. Amen. Amen. And as we praise the Lord, remember we're doing it together as brothers and sisters in Christ. So put a smile on those faces. If you want something to smile about, you know God loves you. And guess who else loves you? Pastor Gil. Mwah! So greet your brother and sister in the Lord. Go ahead, greet one of them and let them know we're here to serve and to worship our God, who is worthy of our praise. This is the day, hallelujah, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, it looks good. It might only be a few of us today because we're traveling. You're traveling. We're all over the place, all over the world, taking your vacations. Oh, but it's good to see God's people who have all come together for this time of worship. Oh, it's so good to see you having that time of fellowship, because now together we're going to worship him. We're going to adore him. We're going to magnify him. Put your hands together again and say, God, to you be all glory and honor. Amen. Brother Kenneth, come.
Good morning. Boy, Pastor Gil feels good today. So we better sing, if you know what's good for yourself. Like a river glorious, is God perfect peace, over all victorious, in his bright increase. That's number 185. shelter, shelter, a shelter, a shelter in the time of storm. The Lord our rock, in him we hide. What else? Secure well, ill betide. And who's the shelter? Jesus. Jesus. Oh, Jesus is the rock in a very land. A very land, a very land. Okay, number 63, fellas, 61.
Thank you. you've never lost the battle. And I know, you never will. You've never lost the battle. You've never lost the battle. You've never lost the battle. You never will. You've never lost the battle. You've never lost the battle. You've never lost the battle.
Battle is not ours, it's the Lord's, and he don't lose. He doesn't lose any battle. Praise the Lord. Thank you very much, Sister, young Sister Jaina Johnson. Amen. Praise the Lord. Yes. Oh, it's good to see those of you who have not gone on vacation. Oh, you all remember now, keep coming to church, because, you know, more and more of these heathens are going on vacation. I don't know what days go on vacation for. I've never been on vacation in my life. Hallelujah. No, but continue to come out as we worship together, because so many, some are coming back and a whole lot more are leaving this week. And so let's continue to be in prayer for each other as we travel. And we know our God doesn't lose battles. And we know that he's our shelter in the time of storm. So let's stay right here with him. He's the best person to be around and to have in control of our lives. Well, good morning once again, Abundant Life. And if you're here today and you're worshiping with us and you're visiting with us, we want you to stand, because you are important and we're glad to have you visiting with us. So please don't be shy. Just stand so we can recognize you and tell you we're so happy to see you. Come on now, stand if you're visiting with us. I know some people visiting, but don't, oh, they're standing. Okay. Yes, this is Sister Miriam Bowe's family, and they are visiting with us today. I'll tell you why later. So good to have you with us. Thank you very much. Thank you so very much. I'll let you know why all of them have assembled here today at Abundant Life Bible Church in just a few moments. But we want to remind you that we do have prayer tomorrow evening, and we do it online. And the Women's Committee would like you to know that the Monday night prayer link for Women's Ministry has been changed for the month of August to the Women's Ministry Monthly Meeting link. And you're supposed to know what that is. And if you don't know, see Sister Wendy Delaney, and she will very quickly bring you up to date on what the Women's Ministry Monthly Meeting link is. So please be mindful of that, and we will have ours sent out so we can have our time of prayer tomorrow evening at 6 p.m. We also want you to know that the homegoing service for Sister Anna Mae Hamilton has been moved to September the 2nd. It will no longer be this coming Saturday, August 19th. We've moved it, or the family has moved it, to September 2nd. So please make that little adjustment in your calendars or on your calendars. And then we also want to remind you Well, we wanted to let you know. Now, over the next 2 weeks, between Reverend Anthony Roll and myself, we'll be in the pulpit. Reverend Anthony Roll will be next week Sunday, and then I will be the following Sunday. And I want you to be reading a portion of scripture for me. My message is going to be entitled Possessing the Land. Possessing the Land. That's on Sunday the 27th. And Pat and Reverend Anthony Roll will be next week Sunday on the 20th. And the portion of scripture I'd like you to be reading and meditating on in preparation of the message I'll be giving, Possessing the Land, is Deuteronomy chapter 1. That's Deuteronomy chapter 1, verses 19 to 40. Deuteronomy chapter 1, verses 19 to 40. A little sad news for you. If you have not, excuse me, if you have not been informed as of yet, Sister Ada Smith has suffered a mild heart attack, and the family and the pastors and leaders of the church request your prayers for Sister Ada Smith. She is presently in the Princess Margaret Hospital. They took some time to find some place for her because beds are full there. But presently, right now she's on the gynae ward. If that changes, we'll get back to you. So if you would like to visit, that is where she is, on the gynae ward at the Princess Margaret Hospital. And then from Brother Orrin Moss. You know Brother Orrin Moss, he's a missionary. And he and his wife, Brooke, many of us know that they are on the island of Hawaii. And, there are five islands. And but they were not on the island devastated by the wildfire. But their pastor's son is on that island. He's okay, but the entire church that he is serving with, this is the pastor's son, not the pastor, but the pastor's son that they're very friendly with. He lost everything. He and his family lost everything, and the church was completely destroyed. So let's be in prayer for our brothers and sisters on the island of Maui in Hawaii. So please keep them in prayer. And then I understand somebody is celebrating their 100th birthday. 100. They're 100 years old today. It's a very good friend of mine. His name is Ken Bain. Ken Bain, stand up, Mr. 100-year-old, the centennial man. Your wife loves you so much, and she wanted me to, you know, make sure. All right. You recognize your birthday. Okay. I love you, my brother. You get me back later. All right. Last night, I took one of my girlfriends out, and it was a beautiful night. We held hands. We looked into each other's eyes. I took her to a very fancy hotel, and we had some beautiful dinner music. My wife was there, right in front of my wife. I told her things like, she makes my jagged edges so smooth, and she makes my directions so clear, and she gives me purpose for living. You know, she's just such a beautiful lady. And Joey was jealous. That's the first time I ever saw my wife jealous. Because I said all of these things with about 50 people present. And I said all of these things to my darling girlfriend. She is celebrating her 75th birthday. And she was so excited that I would spend this time with her. You know, there was about 50 other people there, but they were, you know, children and grandchildren. One of the grandchildren said, "You can't take my Grammy from me." I said, "I'm not going to take your Grammy from you, but your Grammy loves me, and I love your Grammy." And oh, what a wonderful time. The food was fantastic. The atmosphere was fantastic. She blushed, and she turned red, green. You ever see a black woman turn red, green, and purple? When I was holding her hands and looking in her eyes. That's why her family is here today. Sister Miriam Bow is celebrating 75 years. Sister Miriam, stand. And she acknowledged, with all of the people present, she acknowledged that I am the love of her life. Am I lying, family? That's the truth, right? Yes, yes, Sister Miriam, we love you. Mwah. Okay. It's so good to have you out with your family this morning. It was a wonderful time. It was so good. And I didn't look so good. I was in a tie and suit. You should have seen me. And I was so excited. My back of my jacket went into a bunch of icing. And the back of my jacket was full of icing. I was just so thrilled. I was having myself such a good time. I didn't even know what I was doing. I must have sat in icing. But hallelujah, we spent that time together. Look at her. See, she's still blushing. Amen. Hallelujah. All right, let's get ready for the Word of God. Pastor Cranston, what's the Word of God this morning? Jonah chapter 3. Okay, we're in Jonah chapter 3. Okay, but you are not going to finish before you go away. Okay, so when you come back, you'll finish it all. Okay, all right, so we're in Jonah chapter 3 today. Let's prepare our hearts to receive what the word of the Lord has to say to us as the man of God delivers the truth of God's word. I'm going to ask the ushers to prepare to take this morning's offering. And the chapel singers, boy, I tell you, y'all dwindling because some more y'all leaving for vacation, right? Yeah. Yeah, they're leaving us one by one, and then they'll be back in a few weeks, but get your rest. Let's give thanks for what we're going to give to the Lord in our tithes and our offerings this morning, and continue to give and to give generously, and joyfully unto the Lord. Almighty God, once again, our hearts are grateful that you've allowed us to assemble in this house of worship. God, we might be few in number today because some are resting. And once again, we want to pray that your hand of protection and mercy be upon them as they travel and bring them back to us safely and help them to have a wonderful time of rest and relaxation, but always to remember you. Wherever they travel, that they are representing the Lord Jesus Christ. And God, today we thank you that we're able to give back to you that which you have blessed us with. And in a few moments, God, the word of God is going to be open, and the man of God is going to deliver what you have to say to us today. And so, God, we pray that the Holy Spirit of God once again will use him in a very powerful and a very mighty way to pour into our lives. Continue to bless. We ask and say these things in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen and amen. The chapel singers and then Pastor Cranston knows with his message for today.
Praise me. Thank you. Thank you, chapel singers, for that this morning. And it is good to be with you today. Last week, I was not here. And actually, I forgot that I wasn't supposed to be here. I had planned that we were going to finish Jonah this month. And I forgot that we had a family reunion in Freeport that was scheduled at least for a year. And so had to slip over to Freeport last week. And I'm going to ask you to pray for me because I'm getting ready to travel again. I know a number of people are on vacation. But summer's coming to an end. And it's been a good summer. Usually summer is a little slow and a little different pace. Thank you for your help for the Bible clubs. Over the last 2 weeks, those of you who gave and supported, thank you so much for that. And, you know, we've been in a little bit of summer mode, but for the next 2 weeks, as we close the month of August, this is kind of our ending of our summer season, but I will be traveling, so I'm going to ask for your prayers. I will be off for 2 weeks. I leave on Sunday. I'm heading to Pensacola. I will be there doing the opening revival for their school, their high school. So it's Pensacola Christian Academy, grades 7 to 12. I'll be speaking for their open revival for the week. And so if you would remember to pray for me as I preach to teenagers next week. So looking forward to that. So I'll be in the high school there, my college alma mater. And then the following Sunday, I will be at Hampshire View Baptist Church in Virginia. They're flying me there before I get back to the Bahamas. So I'll be preaching in Virginia at Hampshire View Baptist Church. Hampshire View Baptist Church. I need to make sure is that the right name of the church? Is that, okay, my wife knows better. Yes, Hampshire View Baptist Church. Actually, Hampshire View was here many years ago for a mission trip, I think many years ago. But do pray for me for the next 2 weeks. Much speaking, a number of opportunities that the Lord will bless. And my special happy birthday to Sister Miriam Bow as well. But Pastor Gill overdid it, so I can't even compare. So I'm just saying happy birthday. All right, grab your Bibles. We are in Jonah chapter 3. I thought I was going to just put chapter 3 and chapter 4 together, but I couldn't do it. So I'm going to have to end Jonah in September. And we know Jonah was on his vacation break from God. And so his vacation time, we were supposed to be doing Jonah in vacation, but we're going to have to finish him in the fall. And so we are in chapter 3 of Jonah, and I have loved this story. Those of you who've been with us through Jonah, hasn't it been a wonderful journey? Man, I'm telling you, I have enjoyed Jonah. Now, when we started, I said, you know, we usually look at Jonah from the eyes of a child and those children's stories we hear about Jonah. But Jonah is really a book with a lot of meat and a lot of adult thinking that needs to go into it. And so that's how we wanted to really even approach this book of Jonah. And I hope that you've understood it as we've gone through. Now today, as we look at Jonah, we kind of come to each well-written story has this climactic moment. And then it kind of closes, but usually we end on a high. Usually the books we read, we want a happy ending. We want that happily ever after moment. So you come to this beautiful climactic moment, and then you're supposed to have your happily ever after.
Well, we don't really have a happily ever after in the book of Jonah, but we do get to this moment where this is the moment of transformational change. Now, again, one of the things they said as we went through this book, it's a very high, intense book. It's like watching 3D and with all surround sound. That's how this book was written. It is on, it's on high throughout the whole book. All right. So now that you come to this chapter is kind of like Charles Dickens' Scrooge. Remember the Christmas Carol with Scrooge. Scrooge is horrible. You know, bah humbug. He's visited by all of the ghosts of Christmas past, the ghosts of Christmas present, the ghosts of Christmas future. And then there is this change. And he comes out on Christmas Day, the best Merry Christmas. So there's this wonderful change that happened because of this whole journey you've been on. So that is that climactic moment. Well, this is where chapter 3 brings us to that climactic change of the book. And it's beautiful. And so the title of the message today, as we look at Jonah chapter 3, is "It's Time for a Change." Now, that's not a political statement, because I know that's where you went, because that's where I went. But it is a beautiful concept when we get to this story, because it is the story about amazing change. And so let's jump in and ask God to help, because when man repents, so does God. When man repents, so does God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, help us now as we look at this book. And Lord, you've taken us on this journey of Jonah. And in many ways, I'm not even sure why we as a church have gone through this, but many times you prepare us. And so I pray that we'll get what we need as we study it through. And Lord, I pray that you'll help us today understand your word. May we leave today changed and different, because we've been around your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, there are three simple points today. The amazing change in Jonah, an amazing change in Nineveh, and an amazing change in God. And so those are the three points today. And so let's jump right in. The amazing change in Jonah. Now, we start chapter 3 with "the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the second time." And we ended last week saying, "the God of second chances." So, as we begin with Jonah, this is the turning point moment. See, Jonah, for those of you who have not been with us on this journey, Jonah, I would say, in my estimation, is the worst prophet in the Old Testament. And he has a whole book. All right? Now, hopefully I've been able to prove that after the last few weeks. But Jonah, most of our children know about Jonah more about him than any other prophet. But he was not really a good prophet. Why? Because when God gave him a prophecy, he ran. Like, what prophet gets a word from God and runs? Chooses not to deliver what God said. So Jonah is the prophet on the run. And so here we spend a few weeks talking about how God relentlessly went after Jonah. He was called by God. He is given a position of a prophet, and he was given the word of God. And I would say there may be many in church who are running from God when they're supposed to be working for God. Amen. They're still running. And so this was Jonah on the run. But one of the things we proved, hopefully, if you were here, is God runs after. He went after Jonah and he sent his mission agents, and I'm not going to go through all of that again. But God goes after Jonah, and then last week we saw Jonah's prayer of repentance. So now Jonah goes through what I call repentance. And it's just the review of chapter 2. What is repentance? That's important because that's what this week is about in chapter 3. What is repentance? Well, repentance is a change of mind that produces a change in your action that results in a change of direction. Okay? So repentance is a change of mind. That's literally what the word means, to change your mind. So repentance has to have change. So it's a change of mind. But many times we don't understand that it's what we, one of the words theologians throw around is, it's a pregnant word. In other words, it's a word full of life and potential. It's a full word. And so sometimes when we look and say, did you repent? This is what we think that means. I said sorry. That's what we think repentance many times means when we come to God. So God says, you have done wrong. This is wrong. You shouldn't be doing that. You shouldn't be acting like that. That should not be your lifestyle. Well, I'm sorry. And we think, now God, you should be happy with that. See, that's our understanding of repentance. That's why I'm changing that so you could have a full understanding of repentance. Repentance is a change of mind. So you're thinking different. Then it comes into a change of action. If you're doing the same thing, the question is, did you repent? So it comes to a change of action, and the action always produces a change of direction. Why? Because you are repenting from and repenting toward. Okay? So that is full repentance, just so we understand. Because a lot of people will say sorry, and they think that because I said sorry, everything should be fine. Well, God is saying, you said sorry, let me see, because words easy. I'm looking at the heart. All right, so once we understand that, so now Jonah, now this is such a tricky book, because, oh boy, sometimes I wish we didn't know the end of the story, you know, but we all know the end of the story. But Jonah goes from this runaway prophet that gets this word from God to this moment in the belly of the fish. The last time we were together in the belly of a fish. Now that's a place to be. And we talked about 3 days. It took him 3 days to repent. Now how long do you have to be in your mess before you change your mind and turn to God? God brought him down. It was like God orchestrated all these events to get Jonah to the point of understanding his need of God. You need me. And so then in chapter 2, finally, we see the prayers come up. And he says, when I was afflicted, and we talked about that, then I cried unto the Lord. That's chapter 2. So this is, this again, following this is just beautiful. So God does all of this to get Jonah back to Nineveh. All right. Which is still amazing to me. So what is the process then of Jonah's repentance from chapter 2? One, he recognizes the need of God. In verse 2, he said, I cried. Jonah chapter 2, verse 2. And said, I cried by reason of my affliction unto the Lord. First of all, if there's true repentance, there is a recognition of need. And this is where he says, Lord! So he cried unto the Lord. He knew he was a sinner. He knew he needed God. Then there was a refocus. Look, we got that from verse 4. Then said I am cast out of thy sight, yet I will look again. We talked about that word cast out was the word for divorced. He felt broken away, divorced from God. That's how he felt. Then he said, I will look again. So he got his focus right. See, in the path of repentance, what needs to happen first is you need to first come face to face with the fact that there is a God who's in control. Or else you're never going to turn. Once you come, boom, because sometimes God lets you go until you hit something that you cannot move. He just lets you go. You think you can do it? You think you can do it? You think you can do it? Okay, keep going. Keep going. Then you hit. And this is where Jonah was. And so then there had to be that recognition. Then refocus. Get your eyes on God. And so if you're running from God, I'm going to tell you, wait for it because you're going to hit. If you don't have a soft heart, which means your heart is hard, what needs to happen to a hardened heart is a breaking. And God will allow the breaking to happen so that the growth can happen. All right? And so that's why we come to church. That's why we keep telling our teenagers to keep your heart tender and soft. Because if it gets hard, then you need to break it. So that's what happened. Get your eyes. Then once that happens, then you refocus. Says, I will look again. And then there was a reflection. I remembered the Lord. That's what he said. There was a change in his thinking. His brain had to change. He looked and remembered. There had to be a belief change. I have to think right about God. That's what all of that is in. I remember the Lord. This is all review. And then it comes back. He's then returned. And in verse 9, he said, I will sacrifice unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that I have vowed. You see, repentance without this part here, that is so needed. What was he saying? I am sorry for what I have done. I will focus my attention on you, Lord. And so he's getting things right by remembering the Lord, making things right, and then making decisions on what he's going to do. I will sacrifice praise. I will pay my vows. All of that, you know what he's saying is, I will do whatever it takes, even if it hurts. I'm going to do it. See, this is getting right. See, we have such a weak, wishy-washy Christian walk. We want to be easy. Lord, I only come in if you're making it easy, and if you're going to bless me and bless me good. If ain't no blessing in this, I out of here. And as soon as the storm comes, then you're ready to talk bad about God and the church and everything. See, God is making tough Christians. Why? Because we're in a battle. We are in a battle. And so here is Jonah coming and says, I will sacrifice praise. I will sacrifice unto thee the voice of thanksgiving. Lord, I will thank you even in the midst of this hard time. See, he got his eyes off his circumstances and onto his big God. And then he said, I will pay that I have vowed. I'm willing to pay it. All right, so now Jonah is responding right with repentance. That's when we get to verse 3. And the word of the Lord came again the second time. So what? God responds to Jonah. God's response was the second chance. He is a God of second chances. I do not know what you have done, where you have been, and all of the water under the bridge. One thing I know is we have a God of second chances. If your heart gets soft, we have a God ready and waiting. He's the God of second chances. So the Bible says God came a second time unto Jonah. Now remember, Jonah just got spit up on the ground, you know, vomited by a fish. And God came up to him and says, okay, Jonah, remember what I said? Yeah, that hasn't changed. Arise, get up. But I just spent 3 days in the belly of a fish. I've had a bad 3 days, Lord. It's been rough. Arise, get up, go to Nineveh. The Lord is very clear. So he took him back to where he got off. You know, that's what the Lord does many times. He has to take us back to where we got off and say, okay, you got off here? Okay, come back, right back here. Remember, that ain't changed. You still got to do that. Remember that? Well, all of this was to skip that. Yeah, I know. Come right back here. This is the step of obedience you missed. Come right back here. Make this right. And so he came back. And then the difference here is God gave him the same message, but the end is different. Let's look at the first time he says in chapter 1, verse 2, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. That was the first command. That's the one he disobeyed. This is the second one. Verse 2 of chapter 3. Arise, go into Nineveh, that great city, and preach unto it the preaching that I bid thee. He ended it with, preach what I tell you. Because you may be going there going, I don't even know what to say. What do I talk to these people about? So he's, okay, prophet, I will give you the word. So what didn't change? It was very clear that God told him to arise. There was urgency. What are we waiting for? Jesus coming soon, you know. Urgency. Go to Nineveh. Preach. The word here is preach. That's one of the things that changed in this passage. He talked about preach. And we're going to look at that soon because he gives the priority of preaching. Then he says, preach what I tell you. And then Jonah obeyed. That's the change. Verse 3, Jonah arose and went unto Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. And I want us to grab this because when Jonah obeyed, he obeyed not knowing the end. All right, we know that we have the end of the story. But when Jonah obeyed, he didn't know the end. So there were two results, only two, probably in his head and in mine. It's not written. But what do you think the two results would be of him going to Nineveh? Only one or two. One would be the people will repent. But what would the other be if they didn't repent? What do you think would happen to him? They probably would kill him. Okay? So this is reality, and we're going to look at that soon. In his head, I am going. And only two results on this. Either I am dead, or the people will repent. Only one or two. But I will obey. See, this is where God wants to bring so many of his people. Because we're scared. You know, there's so many things that are holding us back. And God says, are you ready to go? But Lord, I will go if. See, God has to get us to a point where we erase the if. And say, I will go full stop. Let the results be in your hand. Wow. See, this is amazing. This is where God wants Jonah to be. So, and God took him through all of this to get him here. Now let's look at Nineveh. So that's the amazing change in Jonah. Boy, I tell you, God took him through something to get him there. Now the amazing change in Nineveh. So we see the next verse says, now Nineveh was an exceeding great city of 3 days' journey. So the Bible now lets us start talking about Nineveh. Now, I've been waiting to get to this Nineveh part throughout the series so we can understand. Let's look at the history of Nineveh. Where did Nineveh come from? Now don't lose me now, because I need you to connect this, because this is important for the whole understanding of this people. Where did Nineveh come from? So we have to look at Genesis chapter 10. Genesis chapter 10, verse 8 to 11 is first mention, and we talk about laws of first mention here. But Genesis chapter 10, and we see the introduction of Nineveh. I'll read the whole passage and I'll explain it. It says, and verse 8, and Cush begat Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one in the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Wherefore it is said, even Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord. And the beginning of his kingdom was Babel. So that's Babylon. Jump down to verse 11. Out of the land went forth Asher. So he went out from, his kingdom started at Babel or Babylon, and he went to Asher. This, the word Asher is Assyria, and builded Nineveh and the city and the other cities. Okay. Who was the one who built this city of Nineveh? And we believe it's the same one all the way back to Jonah's time. This is built by Nimrod. Now, I'm not sure, I'm not going to do the whole history of Nimrod, but we'll know that mighty hunter is the same concept of tyrant. So he was a tyrant leader who wanted to create a kingdom. And we see that. And we also know Babel by the Tower of Babel. And so the Tower of Babel was where the people went to try find their own way to God. All right? And so this man has a lot of wicked history. Do not name your child Nimrod, and don't call him one. Okay? It's not a good name. All right, so here is Nimrod, who was this mighty hunter or tyrant, creates this kingdom and started in Babylon, straight down to the land of Assyria, where he creates another capital city of Nineveh. And this area is actually called the land of Nimrod. Okay, so this is the land of Nimrod. So I called specifically two cities deliberately, Babylon and Nineveh. All right, now let's go to present day. So we're going to skip over from where Jonah is. So we go from its history, past, to its present. Now, I don't know if anyone remembers where I said Nineveh is located today. I said that in the introduction. But it is located in the country of Iraq. Actually, where the city of Mosul is today in Iraq is where the city of Nineveh was. So, to the north of Iraq, to the north is Nineveh. In Iraq, to the south, is where Babylon was. So both Nineveh and Babylon were in Iraq. And if you go from Nineveh to Babylon, right in the middle is today's capital of Iraq, which is Baghdad. So Baghdad is actually located right between Nineveh and Babylon. Now some of you are going, I don't know what that means. Well, it means that even today, the center of tyranny, or the center of hate and war, that thinking that uses a religious ideology that combines it with war to bring fear to lead, is even still today. Okay, and so this is its past, this is its future. Now let's look at what it was today. So today, well, not what it was for today, what it was for Jonah's day. And so, just and again, that connection, the terrorist home of ISIS is in Iraq. And so ISIS, the Islamic State, that the home, the hub, the military force of the Islamic movement that has that religious connection and violence is right there. So I want you to think that when God called Jonah as someone from Israel to go to Iraq, to Baghdad, and preach in their streets and tell them to repent. You see, this is not a small deal for him. This is why he was on the run. Lord, them people need to be punished. If there's anyone who should burn, let them burn. This is where he was. So I want, what if, now not even talking about a Jew today, if God called a Jew and sent him to preach to ISIS in Baghdad, it would be equivalent. But what if God sent your son to Baghdad to preach to ISIS? Now see, now you're, I know about that. You sure God called you, bro? That was that pizza you eat last night, man. See, this is the reality of this message. This is the reality. Because again, we look at this as this little beautiful kid story. No, it is a beautiful kid story. But it's more than that. God is giving him this message to the worst people on earth at the time. And said, they need to hear the gospel too. Oh, man. So, what is the context of that day? Well, Nineveh was considered the largest city in the world at that time. That's why the emphasis is given to how many days' journey. Look at it. That's an odd statement. After verse 3 of chapter 3, so Jonah arose and went unto Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now, Nineveh was an exceeding great city of 3 days' journey. What? What does that mean? Well, actually, it is said that the suburbs of Nineveh, including the suburbs, it was 60 miles around the city. And so the city proper, not including the suburbs, the city proper had walls that were about 100 feet tall and 50 feet wide. That was the wall surrounding the city proper. All right, so this was a major city of the day. The people were cruel. I won't go into all the cruelty of the people, but understand the center of worship was the goddess Ishtar. The goddess Ishtar was the goddess of fertility or sexuality. And she had wings, so was considered also the goddess of war. Interesting, the combination. And so this was what the city was about. Two things, violence and immorality. Those were two major issues, things about this city. And it was known for their cruel treatment of the enemy. If there was an enemy, and they had to conquer the people. They wanted everyone to know they wanted to strike fear in their own troops and everyone around them. That's why we kind of call them the terrorists. Why? Because this is how they maintain control. They would put the skulls of all of their victims on poles around their city walls. And then, again, just another aspect, they would skin and use the skins on the walls of their victims. And just talking about how they buried them. They were cruel. This is what Jonah was walking into. I only say enough to say this was not a walk through a garden. When he started toward that city, and every step toward the city, his heart probably was pounding. And then he got to the city, to the big, but then the Bible even makes it very clear when he gets to the city proper. Let's read on. It says, and Jonah began to enter into the city a day's journey. Okay? And so now he gets to the city proper. It says, and he cried and said, yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. So we see the people and its history was wicked. But we see that God had a simple message. It wasn't complicated. What it was? Judgment is coming. That's it. Boy, it wasn't all fancy. Jonah, I doubt he looked good. He just came out of a fish. So it wasn't about Jonah and his swagger or his pizzazz or his charisma. None of that. He didn't even want to be there. I don't think he preached with a little bit of gusto. It is that this is what God tells me to say. Now come kill me. I think that was his head in his head. I'm going to die. I'm going to die. So he gets in there in illustration, the walls of Baghdad. Watching ISIS. God said, y'all got 40 days. 40 days, and y'all will be destroyed. Just take me now. You know? They actually said if you were beheaded, it was considered a mercy killing. So that is the, it's like, can someone shoot me? Something like, why don't capture me and torture me, please? That's probably all that's going on in his head. But he's giving the message, which is important. The message. Now, Brother Dennis, you all are back. It's so good to have Brother Dennis and the team back. We talked about when they were in London and giving the faith, sharing their faith during the sports event, and just how people responded. You know, people are not open and receptive to the gospel these days because of really the ideology that's gone around the world globally. The secularism is actually saying that the Christians are the terrorists. And so there's this move that's already changing globally. So that's another message. But we actually live in a culture that is not receptive. But that culture wasn't either. But God sent them. He sent him to Iraq, to ISIS. That's our thinking. And he did with one message. Now this message, this is the power of preaching. And this is the beauty because, you know what? God uses the foolishness of preaching. We think it's about the preacher, and it is not. It is not about the preacher. We, the people, make it about the preacher. And then the preacher believes their hype. And then that's the preacher's downfall. It isn't about the preacher. It isn't about all the fancy things we can do either. You know what he had? The message. And God showed up. Now, many times we read this story and we think the miracle is the fish. The miracle is not the fish. The miracle of Jonah and the book of Jonah is not the fish. We even see people, I talked last week, someone gets swallowed by a whale. Well, not all in the belly, you know. But at least we, you know, like, okay, And we can all debate, was that a real whale? Was that a fish? You know, and how could you get in with the juices? And how could he say, oh, yeah, blah, 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 blah. We already did that. The miracle is the revival that hit this land. That's the miracle. Imagine if one Jew went to Baghdad and the whole country was changed. ISIS put down their weapons. People closed the mosques. They started opening churches. They started because of one Jewish evangelist. See, that is mind-blowing. Like, what? You're talking about a man getting swallowed by a fish, but Iraq changed overnight because of one preacher? Look at what happened. This is the change. Amazing response of the people. Again, understanding the kind of people they were and the fear that the people were under. Look at the response. It says, for the word, verse 5, sorry. So the people of Nineveh believed God. Not Jonah. Jonah had a message. They believed God and proclaimed a fast and put on sackcloth from the greatest of them to the least of them. From the nobility to the man on the street. When they heard that, something happened in their heart. And they went on their knees and they put on sackcloth and they declared a fast. See, this is repentance. Understood what happened first. What happened first? Based upon the scripture, what happened first? Read it. It's there in your Bible. In verse 5, what did they do first? What happened to them first? They believed God. And a change began to happen. See, this is what was going on. We know what God... You said what? Now, we're going to talk a little bit later. I actually think that they heard about Jonah's predicament. I believe that probably they heard about him being in the belly of the whale. Probably they heard about this, but I'll hopefully prove that before you leave today. But they believe God is the real God. Whoever you're talking about, that one, he's the real God. And if you say we're going to be destroyed in 40 days, that will happen. Yes. Do you know, do people believe that God will send them to hell? Do people actually believe that God will send them to hell forever? Do you actually believe that your unsaved friends and relatives will be forever and ever and ever and ever burning in hell if they do not trust Christ? Do you believe God? See, sometimes the reality of the judgment does not hit home. So we play games. We play like, it's like those guys on the motorbike and they're popping wheelies thinking, I will always, always survive. I will always survive. Are you indestructible? Oh, you only need to hit one little pebble. Because life is so fragile. One hit on the head, and you may never be conscious again to trust Christ. See, the reality of judgment is what hit them. And they started to repent. So the people were amazing to me. That was an amazing change that hit those people. These people who feared, I mean, they lived a life of fear, but they feared God now. But what was even more is the king. Because the king is the lead. The king is the one who would say, put the heads on the poles. The king is the one who would say, this is how we want to torture them. The king is the one who had to demand terror and control. He was that one of Nineveh. So what was amazing here is the king. And let's read on. For the word came unto the king of Nineveh, and he rose from his throne, and he laid his robe from him, and covered him with sackcloth and sat in ashes. Now, any military leader who does that, all the troops will be like, he's a weak leader, let's overthrow. And the king would know that. But this king did not care. He took off the royal robes and put on sackcloth. Not only that, let's go on. The Bible says, and he caused it to be proclaimed and published through Nineveh by the decree of the king and his nobles, saying, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock taste anything. Let them not feed nor drink water. Well, the people said, let's fast. The king said, not only y'all fast, no animal around here will eat either. You will not feed a horse. You will not feed a cow. You will not feed a sheep. Nobody eats in this land. And nobody will drink. Now, that's a... What? See, this is the miracle of Jonah. I do not know what kind of presence came down in that place. This rebellious prophet with the word of God and the power of God. Boy. And the king, I love his attitude. We get his attitude here. He says, verse 8, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth. Those poor horses. I'm sorry, I'm a visual guy. Whenever I read scripture, I'm there, man. So they're taking the saddles off of the horses. Okay, we can't use saddles today. King said, put sackcloth on these horses. You know? So anyway, so let all of them, he's saying, let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily unto God. Not to Ishtar, goddess of war and fertility. No, forget you. You can't do nothing. You'll cry before God. See, there's a change of eyes to see the true God. And so this king says, let them turn everyone from his evil way. Again, the critical word there is turn. That's the word, the concept of repentance. Let everyone from his evil way, let them turn, and from the violence that is in their hands. Time for a change. Time for a change. This is no, I'm sorry. Lord, I'm sorry. Lord, we're sorry. What do we need to do? What do we need to change? We need your presence. We need your mercy. We need you here. We will be destroyed. See, this is the heart. This is where they needed to be. And this king was serious. And I love, this is my favorite statement from this king, verse 9. Who can tell if God will turn and repent and turn away his fierce anger and we perish not? See, this was just the heart of this king. You know, we don't know if God will do it or if he won't. We're not here to force God into doing anything. But we're here crying on the mercy of God. We're here begging on God's mercy. Wow. So this was the remarkable change in Nineveh. That was amazing. But also, the last verse is amazing. This is an amazing change in God. The Bible says, and God saw their works, that they had turned from their evil way, and God repented. This is one of those theological verses in theology that we love to debate. How does God repent? There's a few passages in Scripture that deals with this, and this is one of them. And it's an important concept here. Because God repented. What does that mean? Well, it literally means God changed his mind. But what about that verse says, God never changes? That's a bit, we teach God is immutable. What does immutable mean is he never changes. What he was, he ever will be. That's a biblical doctrine. God is immutable. Immutability of God, I think that's how you say it. So God cannot change. But here we have God repented. It's such a beautiful concept here. So first of all, we do know, based upon this scripture, that God saw. What did he see? Look at the passage. Look at it. What did God see? Their works. Isn't that interesting? Not just their heart, but their works. That they turned from their evil way. God saw there was something he was looking for. See, God isn't into playing games with us. See, God is serious. God wants you to be on the right track, doing the right things, following God. So, you're not serious. So, why should God be? God saw their works, that they had turned. See, all of what they did, that was important to God. That was. And God saw it. And something happened. And the word is used, God repented. Or God changed his mind. So for us to grasp the word repent, the answer for me is, this is the literary language to help us understand the action of God. Which simply means, just as though God does not have eyes, God does not have ears, we say God sees, God hears, the hand of the Lord moves. Those are terms used. This is the beautiful literary picture. Read it. If you read it, this is how it connects. And it's really beautiful written. In verse 9, this is the king. This is the king. Who can tell if God will turn and repent? And then it reads the next verse. Well, God repented. You know what he was doing? He was kind of using the king's concept. Listen, you repent, so will I. In other words, if you change, I will. But did God change? The answer is the character of God never changes. God doesn't change. His character, which simply means he is true, he is honest, he will do what is right by you every time. His character cannot change. But when you change, you align yourself up with the other part of his character. So that which was going to be, my character says, I have to punish sin. Now my character says, I will welcome the repentant one. See, my character, the truth that I cannot change is the basis for this change. If that makes sense. The action changed because your action changed because I never changed. You just aligned yourself up to me. And my divine will from the beginning was for Nineveh to be saved. That was my will. Now you all finally line up. It's a beautiful picture of God. See, you're running, and God's after you. You feel like you're getting whip. Then you change, and all of a sudden you get hugs. God change? No, you change. So now you're able to see this part of God's character. You only got that part before. But now you get this part. It was always there just waiting for you. It's God is amazing. Which brings us down to now, what does that have to do with me? All through this chapter, God's mercy is on display. God is merciful. What you deserve? What if God gave you exactly what you deserve right now? Boy, we're sinners, but for the grace of God, God used a broken preacher to deliver one of the greatest messages that caused the what we consider the biggest revival in all of Scripture. And this man was used not because he was great, but because of the grace of God. God may be calling a young man here today. Don't run, but what if God calls me too? Well, okay, but for the grace of God, go. Go for the grace of God. Because it's not about who you are. It's about the hand of God, his power, and his word using you to accomplish what he's called you to.
Hallelujah!
See, God may be calling you. Don't run. Accept the call. Boy, we need some people in Iraq, don't we? Y'all ain't saying strong amen to that one. We need someone to the Muslims. We, in this church, we've talked about what's happening in the Muslim world. You know the need. Maybe God is calling. That's when we start saying, God called them, but not my child. God even called Pastor Cranston, sent him, but not. Whatever it is, if God is calling. See, when Jonah accepted, he did not know the outcome. But either way, he knew he wouldn't like it. That's where he was. That's why he ran. So the mercy of God to Jonah. But you know what? God used Jonah as the example. There's this, and I'm going to close with it, Luke chapter 11. This is a precious little verse I found in my study. I do not know how I missed this, and I've read this verse so many times. Even in this study, I've read it. But just a little phrase was so precious to me this time. Luke 11, 29 to 32, or 29, 30 and 32. This is, people are asking for a sign. This is what he says. He says, and the Pharisees, 29. And when the people, verse 29, when people were gathered thick together, he began to say, this is an evil generation. They seek a sign, and there shall no sign be given it but the sign of Jonah the prophet. Okay, so Jonah was the sign. For as Jonah was a sign unto the Ninevites, Jonah was the sign to the Ninevites. So Jonah was not only given the message, he was the message. So this is why I say probably either the testimony from those fishermen got to that city, or they heard about this man who was swallowed and it got. But all I know is Jonah was the sign, and it was connected to him being in the fish. Just as Jonah was in the belly of the whale 3 days, so must the Son of Man be in the earth for 3 days. That was the sign. It was the connection. So the sign Jesus said to the people was, I am going to be in the grave for 3 days. So therefore, the sign to Nineveh was Jonah. Do you know? You may be going through some stuff, and God may be making you a trophy of his grace. Look what God could do with a broken vessel. Because it's not about the vessel. It's about the glory of God. See, God could use you. And God desires to. And every young person should almost desire God to use them. And that would be my prayer. Lord, would you use me? So there is the mercy and grace to Jonah. But there's mercy and grace to Nineveh, an unsaved people group. By grace are you saved through faith. It was grace that saved them. Nineveh was horrible. I don't know, and I don't care what you've done. God's grace can save you. And it desires to. God's grace saved these people. They were horrible people. But God's grace meant it. And then God's grace can save us as a country. This is a beautiful picture of revival. You know, in Habakkuk 3, it says, revive thy work in the midst of the years. In the midst of the years, make known. In wrath, remember mercy. When we as a people come to the point of seeing our need of God and will repent, we will see a mighty move of God. We desire, we pray for revival. But in many ways, from our top leaders straight down to the person on the street, we desire our sin more than our God. But when we get to the point of understanding the truth and we're willing to say, Lord, I repent, we will see a mighty move of God. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray, seek my face and turn from their wicked way, then we'll be here from heaven. You know what we need? Jonah, again, this is such a blessing to me. We need just broken vessels with the power of God and the word of God reaching unsaved people. We need you willing to be used of God and obey. We need the power of God to change even the worst. When last have you prayed for the Muslims? When last have we sought the Lord's face over the lost and dying world even around us? Do we even care? See, this is what leads us to the last chapter of Jonah. Right here. Because God is ready. But are we? Do we even care? Let's bow our heads at this time and you know, this has been our summer journey with Jonah, and just learned so much with him. And I've been so appreciative of just how the Lord has opened Jonah for me, and I pray for you. But I'm just going to ask, is there anyone here who would say, you know, Pastor, I am not saved. If I were to die today, I would receive judgment from God. I would go to hell. But I do not desire that. Just like the people of Nineveh, I know I need to repent and change. Is there anyone like that? I am not saved. I need to be saved, and I know it. Pray for me today. Is there anyone like that? And I'll pray for you. Okay. Same question one more time. Didn't see any hands, but I'll ask it one more time. Pastor Cranston, I know that I am not saved. If I were to die today, I would receive judgment, and I know it. But I desire to change today and accept God's free gift of salvation. Pray for me. If that's you, just raise your hand. Last time. Okay. And then the second question is simply this. Now, this would not be a come forward, but just a personal question. But I'm going to ask you to raise your hand if it is you. I want to say, oh, Pastor Cranston, as best as I know how, I have not done this before, but I desire for God to use me in whatever way he can, wherever, to whomever. I pray that that would be my heart before the Lord. Would he use me? I've not prayed that before, but today I'm acknowledging that. Pray for me as I am making that commitment to God. Is there anyone like that? Okay, good. Put your hands down. Good. Good. Anyone else? All right. Let's pray. Father, we have journeyed with Jonah and with you. And Lord, we have seen, Lord, you run after those who are even running away from you. We've desired hearts that do not run. And today we've seen that you can use anyone with your word and your message. So I pray for you to use in a great way. You've seen those hands, those who have surrendered today in that area. I pray that blessing. And then also, Lord, we pray that we would be sensitive to the lost. Give us open eyes to see. Help us to be true repenters and not just say sorry. So, Lord, may we be repentant people because we desire to see revival in our land. We pray these things now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We got one chapter to go with Jonah. It's a good one. You won't miss that one. But let's go ahead now. And Brother Ken, I think we can sing that one, God Leads Us, Their Children. Do you have that number, or you have one for us, Brother Ken?
What number?
God Leads Us, Their Children Along. Maybe you can come up. Song Through the Waters. In shady green. 203. 203.
In shady.